Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Bone to Pixie by Willow Mason. Narrated by Gabrielle Baker. Chapter 1.
Do you want to ride the ghost train?
Lucas asked as we walked away from the Ferris wheel. The air was redolent with popcorn and candy floss, the rich scent of butter making my stomach dance in anticipation. I didn't want to lose that sensation and end up with it twisted in knots from fear.
That depends. How scary is it?
There are 8-year-olds in the line. Lucas pointed to the jostling crowd of youngsters. I'm sure the ride is fairly tame.
Tame I can handle.
I linked my arm through his elbow as we crossed to the attraction. But at the first sign of something really frightening, I'm getting off.
You can't get off the ghost train midway.
Well, that's just poor planning. They should have stops along the journey, like a real train.
Hey, mister!
A young boy called out from the head of the ragged queue.
If you pay my fare, I'll let you sit in front with your lady friend.
My name's Elisa, not lady, and I'm happy at the back, I yelled before Lucas could respond.
But the front carriage is the best, the boy insisted. If you want your girlfriend to end up in your lap from fright, you can't go past it.
Right, I think that's it, I said, turning to go. If this ride is scary enough to attract that boy, it's not something my nerves can handle. A clucking noise sounded, and I whirled around, narrowing my eyes at Lucas. Did you just try to shame me into taking a ride when I don't want to?
Not me.
He shoved his hands into his pockets, staring into the sky, then at the ground. The latter motion revealed the faint balding circle in his hair that I inexplicably found attractive. But I couldn't forgive someone just because I fancied them.
You take the train and I'll wait here, I told him, crossing my arms. And if you come out the other side okay, I'll reconsider.
You're leaving me to ride the ghost train alone? Now that is scary.
Sad is the word, mister,
the kid from the front called out, chuckling before he turned his attention to me.
If you're really scared, just close your eyes and it'll all go away.
Obviously, a child who didn't have a mind's eye that delighted in frightening them. If I closed my eyes when I saw something slightly scary, my mind embellished it into a freak show of pure terror. The train came to a stop in a cloud of dry ice, and the current passengers disembarked. None of them seemed perturbed, but I'd already made up my mind and I didn't want to remake it.
You're sure? Lucas asked as he slid into a carriage. Last chance.
I'll stay out here and test the candy floss.
All the sugar on sale around here is the scary thing, Lucas said with a smile, as though he hadn't demolished 2 toffee apples on arrival at the funfair.
Another man waiting in line joined him in the dual-seated car, and I waved goodbye as the train jerked awake, carrying its payload into a dark tunnel. Just as I decided to make good on my candy floss venture, a voice yelled, "Boo!" into my ear.
Maisie!
I pressed a hand to my chest, wishing the woman was solid enough for me to give a good slap.
Please don't ever do that again. Don't look now, but someone's talking to themselves, Maisie said with a cheeky grin. You remember most of these folks can't see me, right?
I hadn't, but soon shuffled away from the few curious glances to stand near the edge of the ride. With a mobile phone against my ear, I felt safe to continue the conversation.
What are you doing here? Shouldn't you be inside the ride, giving everyone a good fright?
She sniffed. Barely anyone who's on the train can see me.
And how lifeist of you, assuming ghost is the only job I could get? I can do other things too, you know. Like playing pranks?
Posy said, coming up beside me and peering intently into my face. Are you okay, Elisa?
Rosie sent me over here to see if you needed help to bail on your date.
I don't want to bail on my date. I'm having a lovely time.
Standing out here while your companion enjoys himself inside.
Posy put her hands on her hips.
What's the matter?
I've had enough scares from ghosts to last a lifetime, I said, putting my phone away. So I thought I'd enjoy a sugar overdose instead.
Oh, candy floss!
Posy clapped her hands together, then beckoned for her sister to join us.
We've already thoroughly tested the caramel corn and toffee apples and can verify they're good. Time for dessert.
As if those didn't count as dessert, Rosie said with an eye roll.
We're meant to be watching our diet, remember?
This time I'll eat and you can watch. When we get to the salad course, I'll return the favour. Rosie tried to frown at her twin, but ended up laughing.
Fine. We'll start tomorrow. Monday,
Maisie said, wavering for a second before fully materialising again.
Diets should always start on a Monday.
Preferably, they should always begin next Monday, Posy said, catching the candy floss seller's eye.
That way the dreaded day will never arrive.
I picked a medium-sized serving and pulled the sticky strands out of the paper cone, letting the pink-coloured treat melt on my tongue.
Delicious.
And it matches your hair so well, Maisie said, then sighed.
I wish I could still eat. You've no idea how each day stretches out when you can't break it up with 3 meals and a snack.
Nor do I want. I broke off as a man screamed inside the ghost train ride. The sound was piercing, unlike the other muffled shouts of good-humoured fright. The ride operator stood near the queue of people waiting for their turn. At the shout, he moved towards the controls for the train, then turned and stared along the oncoming track instead.
Goodness, Posy said, grasping for her twin's hand. That doesn't sound good.
Another high scream tore through the air. I ran for the doors where the ghost train should emerge, my blood pounding like a drum in my ears. It couldn't be. It shouldn't be. But that sounded exactly like Lucas.
Stop the ride,
I shouted as the operator stood, indecision freezing him in place.
We have to get them out of there.
It'll be quicker to let the train run, Rosy said in a calm voice, pulling me away from the track.
It must be close to the end of its circuit.
But it sounds like someone's in pain. I rubbed my fingers against my scalp, loosening some pixie dust in case it was needed.
Shouldn't we? Here it comes.
Posy gave a cry of relief as the train nosed through the rubber flaps. The boy who teased me earlier sat in the very front carriage, his face pale. In other circumstances, I would have thought it served him right, but now it only added to my trepidation.
Lucas! Oh, thank goodness!
I jumped as close to the ride as I could get, reaching over the empty seat to touch his shoulder. He slumped forward, eyes closed and nose bleeding.
Help!
A whiff of smoke flew out from my fingers, curling around Lucas's cheek. The magic cleared away the blood and turned the reddening skin back to its usual colour.
Lucas, can you hear me? There's a St. John's tent around the corner, Rosie shouted, pointing. I'll fetch a first aider to come and help.
I clambered over the edge of the carriage into the empty seat, cradling Lucas's unconscious head against my chest.
It'll be okay,
I whispered, more for my benefit than his. Everything will be okay.
What happened? The operator asked the boys in the first carriage. If one of you lot threw something in there, I'll have you banned.
We didn't do nothing,
the first boy exclaimed, appearing on the verge of tears.
There's something wrong with your train, and it's not funny.
His friend pulled at him, vaulting out of the train carriage before the door released.
We're out of here. You're lucky we don't ask for a refund.
Although his friend wasn't as steady on his feet, they soon scarpered. As I watched them run out of sight behind a popcorn stand, I thought of sending one of the waiting crowd after them, then didn't. In a town as small as Oakleaf Glade, somebody would know who they were if the police needed to talk to them.
"What's happening?"
Lucas said in a bleary voice, blinking his eyes slowly.
"Who are you?"
"It's Elisa. Just stay put," I hastily added as he struggled. "You've had a hit on the head, and a first aider's on their way." I scanned the crowd, growing larger as passengers disembarked and other fairgoers came over to investigate the fuss. With a relieved gasp, I saw Rosie hurrying back with two harried St. John's staff in front of her. I waved and jumped out of the train to give the helpers room.
"Did he say anything?"
I clutched at Rosie's right hand, while Posy grabbed hold of her left. "His voice is groggy and I don't think he knows what's going on." I tried to keep my voice level, but it broke, betraying me.
"Don't worry," Rosie said, squeezing my fingers. "No one in town has a harder head than Lucas Bronson, and that's a fact."
One of the first aiders shone a small torch in Lucas's eyes, while the other took his pulse. The action absorbed me to where I didn't hear the footsteps behind me until a hand fell on my shoulder. I jumped a whole inch.
"Sorry to frighten you,"
PC Sid Abney said, giving a sheepish smile.
"Just wanted to see how my partner's doing."
"He's doing fine," the paramedic with the torch said, stepping backwards.
Dale Blossom, according to his badge.
"There's no trace of any injury."
I held a hand up to my mouth as I realised my spontaneous burst of magic had wiped away evidence. Sid must have caught my horrified glance because he bumped me with his shoulder.
"Don't worry, you can describe everything you saw and I'll take it as gospel."
He fluttered his gossamer wings in a further gesture of reassurance. Although I preferred Lucas's company, the twins were right that a supernatural police officer was much easier to deal with.
"Leave me alone,"
Lucas grumbled as the paramedic still in attendance tried to wrap a blood pressure cuff around his upper arm.
"There's no need for the dramatics, I'm fine."
"Can you tell us where you are?"
Dale asked, stepping forward with his hands up when it appeared Lucas might stroll away from the entire incident.
"At the fairgrounds,"
Lucas snapped before a cloud of confusion fell over his face. He rubbed the back of his neck, staring around the crowd with irritation.
"Clear away now, there's nothing to see here."
Dale remained unperturbed.
"What day is it?"
"Well, if it's the fair, it's Saturday. Simple."
"And what are you doing at the fair?"
"Being questioned when I should be having a good time."
"You don't have a headache or anything?" I asked. "You were out cold."
"Nope, I'm fine."
Lucas turned and glared at me.
"Who are you?"
"Right." Sid pulled out his phone and dialed. "I'm calling for an ambulance. You're not tracking nearly so well as you think."
"Don't be foolish."
Lucas grabbed at the phone and disconnected the call before it could summon anyone.
"Just give me a minute."
"Are we out on patrol?"
"You're on a date," Sid said, jerking his head towards me.
"With this young lady."
Lucas gave me a confused glance.
"I don't think so. I've never even met her before."
Sid waved the St. John's team away.
"We can take her from here, thanks. Check out the other passengers."
The remaining guests from the ride were huddled close to the attraction, finding more interest in the current situation than the rest of the fair.
"You met me over a week ago," I explained through numb lips, "when I called the station about a threatening note that had been left on my doorstep."
"Nonsense. I'd never date a victim. It's against the police code."
While Sid frowned and I struggled to find the words to tackle such an emphatic denial, the ride operator came over.
"Did you see where the guy next to you got to?"
he asked, pulling at his shirt collar.
The paramedics are trying to sort out what happened, and since he was sitting right there...
The operator trailed off as my eyes widened. A man had climbed into the dual carriage, taking up the seat I'd refused to claim. But I hadn't clambered over him to reach Lucas when the ride emerged from the tunnel. The seat had been empty. As I opened my mouth to tell the operator that, Maisie screamed. She must have gone inside the ghost train ride, because she suddenly spilled out of the side, waving her arms. "You have to come! There's something terrible inside!"
Chapter 2. I sprinted to the tunnel entrance with Sid hot on my heels. Just before we went through the rubber flaps, I turned back to see Rosie holding onto Lucas with a firm grip.
Good.
"Do you have a torch?"
I asked Sid as the change from bright sunlight to darkness blinded me.
"I can't see a thing."
"Stop for a moment and close your eyes,"
he ordered, and I followed his command.
"Count to 60, then open them again."
"I guess you can see ghosts too," I said as I counted out the seconds. "I hope Maisie's not playing another prank."
"No, I'm not," the ghost replied in a huff from right beside my ear. "There's a gigantic hole to another dimension ripped right out of the air in the middle of the ride."
I opened my eyes just in time to see her shudder.
"It's disturbing."
"Can you show us?"
Sid asked. Maisie curled herself into a tiny cloud of white, only her large eyes showing. Ghost eyes instead of a Cheshire cat grin hanging in mid-air.
"It's farther along," she whispered,
reappearing in fits and starts.
"You'll see it straight away."
Something that could scare a ghost sounded horrific to me. I opted to let Sid lead the charge as we ventured down the track. 10 steps, maybe 11, and we both stopped dead and stared. A hole hung in the air above the track. Where my eyes should stare straight into a mummy with unfurling bandages, instead I looked into a whirling abyss of coloured lights and darkness.
"What is it?"
My voice squeaked an octave higher than normal.
"Some kind of vortex," Sid said. Although his voice sounded calm and authoritative, he shook his head the whole time. "It's far enough to the side of the track that the entire train didn't pass through it, thank goodness."
"How could it cause memory loss?"
"Oh," Maisie said, reappearing in her full glory. "That's not specific to the hole of doom over there." She appeared happy to have a question she could answer. "Expose some humans to enough supernatural stuff and they become forgetful. Even if they can't really see most of what's going on, it still has an effect."
The answer didn't sit well.
"So, as long as he's around me, Lucas will keep losing chunks of his memory?"
"Unless you stop doing anything supernatural around him," Maisie said, while Sid inched closer to the gaping hole in reality. "Or have any other supernatural creatures do anything near him?" She scrunched up her face. "Actually, it'll be pretty impossible to avoid."
"Some humans are more susceptible than others," Sid said as he retreated from the vortex, rubbing his forehead. "Lucas has been fine up until now, but whatever this thing is gave him a pretty bad case."
"You knew?"
His eyes darted away from my face as he shrugged.
"Sure. It's why I tried to keep Louise from giving him the supernatural call-outs. The trouble is, he's smart enough to know we're keeping something from him and keeps finding new ways to get around us. If he was thicker or lazier, you'd never have met him at all."
Tears built up behind my eyes and I gulped to keep them falling.
"Where does the vortex lead?" I asked, trying to distract myself from the disturbing news.
"Goodness knows."
Sid pulled a torch from his belt and ventured closer again, shining the beam inside.
You did have a light.
We didn't need it. You can see more if your eyes adjust than we can with the bright light shining.
As he snapped off the torch, I had to agree. A large bubble of green and purple flashes hung in my vision, forcing me to close my eyes and count down again.
I can't see anything in there, Sid said.
If the passenger fell into the hole, he's long gone.
Have you seen vortexes, vortae, things like this before?
Not for a long time. Once a young warlock discovered how to rip holes through space and time, but he made tiny ones and only used it to steal other kids' pocket money. He put his hands on his hips, pursing his lips. Nothing like this. Maisie ventured a tad closer.
It's making a weird sound.
I tilted my head to one side, holding my breath to hear better. The noise emanating from the hole was soft, a rhythmic thump almost in time with my heartbeat. When my heartbeat wasn't going a mile a minute, that was.
It sounds alive. Maybe it's the mouth to a gargantuan space creature.
No teeth,
Sid said in his matter-of-fact voice, failing to dispel the awful thought from my head. Now my eyes had adjusted fully, I could see a faint glow coming from farther along the track. I presumed luminescent paint enhanced the creepiness of the puppets and mechanical frights presented along the ride. As I ventured a few steps forward, keeping strictly to the side opposite the great hole, I scratched a few flakes of pixie dust from my scalp, just in case.
He must have leapt out of his seat to get across to the vortex, I observed, while standing opposite. Never good with right and left, I held my hands out to check and compared them against my memory of the train as Lucas waved goodbye.
The hole was on Lucas's side, so the man must have jumped across him.
That might explain how he ended up unconscious, Sid said, and why he had a nosebleed before you took care of that for him.
I blushed at the thought of using my magic to muddy up a crime scene. Oops, must try harder. It's hard to think about what would make a man so eager to jump. My eyes crept to the vortex, flicking away when the whirling inside made me giddy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.